Hi, everyone. My name is Kevin Gover. I'm director of the Smithsonian's National Museum of the American Indian. We're here today to celebrate Indigenous Peoples Day. Our program is a presentation of a Youth in Action series which highlights conversations about our future with Native young people. And that'll be followed by a musical performance by hip-hop artist Frank Waln of the Sicangu Lakota. Thank you very much for joining us.
Welcome to the National Museum of the American Indian's new series, Youth in Action, Conversations About Our Future. Thank you for joining us. Depending on where you are today, you may be celebrating Columbus Day or Indigenous Peoples Day. And it is important to acknowledge no matter where you are in the United States, you are on Indigenous land. So I'd like to begin by gratefully acknowledging the Native peoples and their ancestral homelands and where we gather today, no matter where you are. And as well as the diverse and vibrant Native communities that make their home here today. In today's conversation, we're going to talk about how our history and our memory is of the past really informs and influences our current racial and social landscape. And joining me today, we have a panel of amazing Native activists that are propelling this conversation forward and really addressing the tension between history, memory, and current movements happening across America.
Today, we are joined by Brook Thompson, an engineering master's student at Stanford. Brook fights for water and Native American rights really on the front lines with policy and political action. Also, Julian Brave NoiseCat, the Vice President of Policy and Strategy for Data and Progress. Next, we have Lina Krueck, an Indigenous Mexican artist, activist, and student at the Metropolitan State University of Denver. She is a reconnecting adoptee who is learning her culture and history. Lina is passionate about social justice and uplifting Black, Indigenous, and people of color voices. Now we have Dylan Baca, a senior at the Blue Ridge High School. And 2 years ago, he started the Indigenous Peoples Initiative. And he works in policy and with lawmakers to advocate and lobby for marginalized populations such as Indigenous people. And at Taíno from the Bronx of New York, we have Alberto Correa III. He was raised to appreciate both the breadth of the life beyond his block and the unique culture and the place where he comes from. He is currently a PhD student at Cornell University studying microbiology and cultivating a scientific space for underrepresented communities. And please stay with us after for a special musical performance by Lakota hip-hop artist Frank Waln. I want to start this conversation by talking about the long history and pervasive use of Native images across, I mean, the United States, but across the world, and how we see that in popular culture. At the museum right now, we have an exhibition called Americans that's showing the images that we see on a daily basis. Nearly everything that has been named or sold has been named or sold with a Native word or image on it. So if you look closely, you can see food products in the grocery store. You can see names in images in the US military. And of course, the most recent debate has been around the use of Native American imagery in sports. So Brick, tell me about your experience with this imagery and how it impacts you and influence your work.
Ayakui, nicknow Brook Thompson, Pichuas Iwak Archie Thompson, Otek Mewok Kok, Portland, Oregon Oak, Nekpulak Lawe, Esse, Nekpichuk Lawe. Hi, my name is Brook Thompson. I'm the granddaughter of Archie Thompson from the Yurok and Karuk tribes in Northern California. And for me, this kind of imagery is something that I cannot get away from, just living in the United States. It has been in my high school teams. It's been at my current university. And like you said, when you even just go to a grocery store, you see this constant imagery and reflection of natives in not always the most appropriate sense. So it's really a part of my everyday life, just being someone who's native in the United States.
Absolutely. It's something that we see, honestly, everywhere. We cannot get away from it. Julian, tell me a little bit more about your experience with this imagery and influenced your work.
Well, first, thank you so much for having me and for the opportunity to talk about these really important subjects with a group of wonderful panelists. I'm just going to introduce myself in my language real quickly, and then I'll answer the question. So bear with me for a sec. Julian Brave NoiseCat when Tsq'escen, when Kikahed Tsq'escen, Alexander Radi, when Kekachet Tsq'escen, Ed Archie NoiseCat, Sequachmach, and Estatlin, and Tsq'escen, which dequen, to Oakland, which dequen, let one poopsman, the Elliot Tiktamik, wa echwe, Piscataway Uluch, wa echwe, Washington, DC. Hi, everyone. My name is Julian. I introduced who my parents are because that's what my people tend to do. We introduce our ancestors, but I won't bore you with that detail. Plus, I don't want you guys to be like Googling my mom and dad. I come from the Sequetmuch and Statliunk nations in what is now British Columbia, Canada, but I grew up in Oakland, California, and I now reside in Washington, D.C., which is the traditional territory of the Piscataway people. You know, there's a couple of different ways that I could answer this question. You know, the first is that actually once my mom got a job offer from a place in Cleveland, and she's not really a sports fan, but when they sent sort of like the gift basket with the job offer, she noticed the memorabilia included this red smiling dude with like a big red feather in his hair, who happens to be called Chief Wahoo and is the mascot of the Cleveland Indians baseball team. And she was horrified, and I was a 3 or 4 year old at the time, and she actually ended up not taking the job because she thought about what it would be like to raise a kid in a city where the Major League Baseball team was a racialized, red-faced sort of representation of her child's people, my race. So that was one way. And then secondly, I live in Washington, D.C. And I'll be honest, like I was not the kind of person who thought that the mascots thing was like the biggest deal. Like I always thought that they were racist and offensive, but it wasn't like the thing that I like to focus on in my journalism. But living here, I was constantly confronted with people wearing the Washington football team's mascot, out and about every single day. And I always wanted to say something and never really knew where to start. You know, how do you start that conversation and say, someone, you're wearing this thing that is a team that, I won't even say their name because I think it's a racial slur. It's offensive to me. And quite often I also see other people of color wearing this thing. And how do we have that conversation across, across race and across such brutal histories? So, I think it's something that I'm still wrestling with. I've written a little bit about it now. And I think that, my mom's instinct, the studies have shown at this point that it was correct, that there is a psychological toll that these things can take on people. And I personally have also experienced that, even though I'm not a kid anymore.
Yeah, thank you for bringing that up. It is something that we've been talking about for so long. You have written countless articles and you've been on panels about these mascots. Same thing with, Brooke, our work, we're always thinking about these images because they are around us. They are constantly in our face and they can be really harmful to development for children. So Lina, I understand you have a different experience as a reconnecting adoptee that grew up outside of your community. What is your perspective about and around this kind of imagery.
First, I want to say thank you so much for having me and letting me be a part of this conversation, because I think it's really important. And as an adoptee who kind of has more of an outside perspective, it has a big impact on me and on my mental health, for sure. I think growing up with a non-Native family, I didn't really know what good representation was versus what bad representation was. But as I've gotten older and as I've learned a little bit more about the history and my history, I can say that it definitely has had a huge impact on my mental health and the mental health of like many other adoptees that I've talked to, because it feels like we're being mocked. It feels very dehumanizing to see somebody that's supposed to be a representation of us used in used for entertainment and something that's that people joke about, and so I guess it feels like people don't see us as real humans. So when I see those images every day on t-shirts and baseball caps and on TV and in gift shops, every time I see an image like that, it can change my whole day. It changes my mood. And after a while, it starts to have a real impact on my mind. And so it's definitely a really pressing issue that I'm glad we're talking about.
Yeah. Thank you for being here and bringing up that element of mental health. It definitely connects with like what Julie was saying, why his mother didn't want to raise a child in Cleveland, because you're seeing that imagery. And Brooke, as a graduate student at Stanford University, I know you have a little bit of a family history there. Can you tell us more about the history of the Stanford mask and how it continues to affect you?
Yeah, of course. So I just started graduate school at Stanford this month, but my history with Stanford has gone past my lifetime. So on my mom's side, who is white, both her parents went to Stanford and they both have graduate degrees from there. So I grew up going to Stanford for the reunions, for just casual events they've had. So I grew up around Stanford University off and on. And while I was there, I got left at a table with some people who, the end of like the boomer age. And while my grandparents left to get drinks or whatnot, I was bombarded by the people around me, all white older graduate students from Stanford, who were talking about how they wanted to bring the Indian mascot back. So in the 1930s, Stanford had the Stanford Indian as their mascot during sports games. And I think it was actually Pop Warner, who was a football coach there and was also a football coach for the Carlisle Indian School, who suggested the mascot. And the mascot was removed in the 1972, after in the 1970s, Native American students started protesting the name and were known to even come to a game and hold up a sign that said, "Indians are people, not mascots." And so after a petition, Stanford removed the mascot. But even after then, there's been students and organizations that have continued pushing to bring the mascot back time and time again. So even though the mascot's not currently around, it's still there and it's still present and the memory is still alive, which is problematic when people don't necessarily realize why it was taken away in the first place. Because to a lot of the students there, that was a part of their Stanford history. And the even more confusing part on top of that is the fact that the person who dressed up as a mascot, like a stereotypical kind of Plains Indian mascot, was named Prince Lightfoot, and the actual person who dressed up was Tim Williams, who's from my tribe, the Yurok tribe. And for me, knowing that most of the connections around, when you think about Indians in Stanford, is around a mascot instead of the students there, is harmful. And on the topic of mental health that was brought up, for me, I grew up really integrated into my culture, so images of mascots affected me less, but I saw how it affected other people's perceptions of me. So when these people I was sitting at the table with were talking about the Indian mascot, they're not going to think of me as a student at Stanford when they think of the Indians. They're going to think of the stereotypical image and their sports games. And I've come across that time and time again through high school, through growing up, through also living in Washington, D.C., where other people have a reduced image of me. And the only thing they know about Native Americans is through these mascots and through these stereotypes and not actually who I am as a person. And for people who don't grow up as integrated in their cultures, it does have a really big impact on Native students' self-esteem when this is all they see themselves represented as. So for me, I have those two histories of Stanford, one of grandparents who actually graduated from there and had that privilege and went through the era of like Stanford Indian, and then the person who was actually playing the role of the Indian, the stereotypical role of the Indian from my tribe, who, you know, at the time were like, no one from my tribe were getting educations from universities like Stanford.
That's a really great point. There's that odd blend between the Native imagery and then, of course, the invisibility of actual Native people. Like what you were saying, when the people joined you at the table, they probably didn't see you and couldn't see you as a Native person because they wanted this mascot back. Because Stanford, you know, did change their mascots, and other universities have changed over the years. But what about the tribes or nations that continued to agree and support some of the images for mascots, such as Florida State Seminoles or even Central Michigan University Chippewas? Julian, what do you think about what that is kind of saying?
Yeah, so I think that there's a pretty convincing body of research, particularly in the field of psychology, that shows that firstly, Native mascots, and that's not just limited to the sort of greatest defenders like the Washington football team or the Cleveland baseball team, but more broadly, when people who are predisposed to racial prejudice see those mascots, it activates more of their prejudice. There's studies that have shown that. At the same time, there are also studies that show that if you show Native children Native mascots and then you ask them, you know, what they see as their potential in life, they are more likely to see limited prospects for them because, you know, they see that the rest of society views Native people in a very limited and stereotyped kind of way. And so that sort of forecloses their own views of the things that they can achieve. So I think that that's a really important body of research that always needs to be at the center of these conversations, because I think it's pretty convincing once you've seen that research that there is real harm that Native mascots in many forms do. At the same time, though, you know, there are various examples of specific tribal nations either supporting or opposing universities or other team names that do or do not represent in some form either well or not well Native people. In Illinois, there's another example of the Illini, which has been retired. In North Dakota, there was for a long time the university mascot of UND was the Fighting Sioux, which has been retired. So I think that there are various examples of tribes taking different sides on this question. But for me, you know, inevitably when you have these mascots and these team names, people end up showing up to the games, wearing headdresses, you know, putting on fake war paint, doing things like the tomahawk chop and war whooping and things of that nature. And so I'm constantly reminded that, you know, there are real psychological tolls to that kind of behavior. And, you know, I do wonder sometimes if some of the tribes that have decided to support these mascots, if they were aware of that research, if they might take a different position.
Yeah, Brooke.
I guess I have 2 points on this topic. One is that I grew up in a town where the closest school to the reservation, because there's no school directly on my reservation, was the Warriors. And they had a stereotypical Plains Head mascot for their team. And a lot of natives in my area, when it was changed, were very upset at that. And I will touch probably on why a little bit later, but they saw that as the representation of themselves. And it was really frustrating for them to have that little bit taken away from them, even if it wasn't good representation. But it's the only representation that we had in that town, especially since there's so many natives who went to that school. But so I see problematic with that school in general and kind of how that situation was handled. But with something like the Florida State Seminoles and the Seminole Tribe of Florida, for me, it's different because the tribe specifically has agreements with the Florida State Seminoles and how they're represented and how they're talked about. And I think the difference there for me is that they have authority and they have that conversation with that tribe. And for me personally, I think the tribe should be able to do what they want in those circumstances. I don't think it's right in every case. And for me, because it's like Native Americans and animals are some of the most prevalent mascots, I don't want to be related in that sense, especially since Native Americans being related to being at the level of animals has been so prevalent through our history and in a way to oppress us that I don't agree with it, but tribes have sovereignty and I think they should be able to have those conversations. And if they come up with an agreement where they see something that represents them in a way they agree with, that they should be able to go along with it. Yeah, I think it's the tribe's decision, but only when the tribe has the say and the power in the conversation versus being left out completely, which we are in most of these cases.
Lina, do you want to add on to kind of your opinion and your stance on tribes supporting or not supporting these mascots?
I agree with Brooke that in every situation is a little bit different. And I think it's cool that some tribes do have relationships with sports teams or schools or universities or whatever it might be, where they can like come up with their own agreement and their own system of how they want to go about sharing themselves with a university like that or a sports team or anything. But I wish I could go around and like have individual conversations, you know, with some of these people and just ask why. Because I guess in my mind and based on my own experience, like I still don't understand it. But there's that topic of representation, whether it's good or bad or, and how much of you want. So it's just still a little bit confusing for me, but.
Absolutely. What you're saying about, is it good or bad? There's a fine line there. So, you know, because if we look at these teams, if you're a sports fan, you most likely grew up cheering for that team your whole life. So you might have traditions with it. So that's why you really enjoy it. And so those who oppose changing team names or mascots will defend them, saying that is honoring Native people. And what you're bringing up is it good or bad? It's kind of around the question of, does the intent excuse the impact? Brooke, what do you think? Does the intent excuse these mascots?
For me, it does not. I mean, there's the saying, the road to hell is paved with good intentions. Just thinking back about how I grew up and the impact it's had on me, I've never felt honored by any of these mascots in my life. And it's hard to say because like I've come across so many people in my life who are Native, who are on the reservation and who are really for these mascots. Not so much because, you know, they like the imagery, but because it's the only imagery they have again. And before I moved to DC, I still saw people on my reservation wear the R word logos and hats and jackets because that's what they saw as their team. It wasn't good representation, but it's the only thing they have to hold on to. And that's hard for me to cope with sometimes and have those conversations and say that we should be asking for more. But these teams, I don't even think were ever meant to honor us because my understanding is a lot of the like Indian mascot tree comes from us being understood as savages and like gruesome warriors or just like people who are only aggressive and didn't take into consideration like people like in my tribe who did a lot of crafts and were known as craftspeople and grew up mainly peacefully, and that these mascots are only to tie like the aggression of Native Americans to that symbol to the sports. So it was never meant to honor us, and it doesn't honor us, at least for me. Yeah, and there's already so much harm that's been done by these. I don't think that any of the healing process has even really started, because even when the mascots are changed, there's still that harm that's already done, and that needs to be worked on as well.
And Lina, you're ready to dive in. You are ready to have this conversation and kind of ask those questions of, you know, who supports and opposes these mascots. So I want to pose the same question to you about, does the intent excuse the impact?
I can really only speak off of my experience and the impact it's had on me, but through the research and just the conversations that I've had with other people, other Natives, it's frightening, really, when you're talking about mental health and the suicide rates and things like that in a lot of our communities. I think every time that we see an image like this, it could push someone a little bit closer to that edge. And when that happens, like every single day, and when people are already feeling so terrible about themselves, about the way that they're portrayed within these mascots, it's really frightening to see and to hear the stories that I've heard from many, many different people. So the intent to honor Native people with these mascots, just at this point, the argument just feels really tired. And it feels, again, it's very dehumanizing. And I just wish that the people who are making that argument would listen to Native people and what we have to say and how we feel, and listen to the impact that it's had on us, because I think that if there was a little bit more listening coming from the other side, then maybe we would be in a different spot than where we are now.
Julian, would you like to add on to thinking about, does the impact, or excuse me, does the intent excuse the impact?
The impact and intent being divergent doesn't change my view on it. You know, we often hear that folks are intending to honor Native people with these mascots, with these team names. But, you know, if you look at like actual surveys of Native people, there was a peer-reviewed one actually that came out a year or two ago. It shows very clearly that Native people not only oppose these mascots, but actually survey respondents who said that they expressed greater affinity with their Native identity actually found the mascots and team names even more offensive, and they were even more opposed to them. So that to me, you know, suggests that it's hard for me to Lina's point to imagine someone really like honoring you if they also aren't listening to you.
Could you talk a little bit more about other names, logos, mascots, and how they're harmful and what comes next?
So, you know, I think I wrote a story earlier this summer about the Washington football team name and how it was on the brink of changing, and then it did in fact change. I think it's important to note that, you know, activists who have been focusing on this topic for decades, since like the 70s and 80s, have tried virtually every single tactic to get that team name to change. And it was not until we had a historic uprising for racial justice this summer led by Black Lives Matter. And, you know, truthfully, when the investors and supporters of the team's field and online stores, folks like Nike, FedEx, you know, those corporations, it was not until they changed their views that ultimately the team decided to change its name. So money does talk. You know, and then at the same time that was happening, there was sort of a fake news story that went around for a minute where it said that the quarterback of the Kansas City football team, the Chiefs, Patrick Mahomes, was, you know, not going to sign a contract until they changed their name. And that was, of course, not a true story. But it did make me really excited, you know, this notion that people and particularly, you know, other athletes would stand up and say that these teams need to change their name. You know, that got me really, you know, hopeful that there would be a broader sort of sea change on this subject. But we have not, unfortunately, seen that yet, although there's a lot of sort of pressure on some of these teams to change their names. And again, you know, this goes back to the impact of the teams, which has been shown time and again to be both detrimental to non-Native people's views of Natives, and also detrimental to Native, especially youth, view of ourselves.
Yeah, thank you for that. What we're really saying is this fight isn't over. You know, we have generations that are fighting for the Washington football team, and it's so much more than that. So what are some sentiments or ideas that people have around mascots that you really want them to challenge?
One thing I've heard time and time again when having this conversation is, why focus on the mascot issue when there's such larger issues in Indian country and for Natives? And for me, I always answer it with, how can you expect us to start to solve these larger issues and problems if we can't get something as simple as a name change or mascot change to happen? These are the, you know, might seem small in contrast to other issues that are happening, especially with environmentalism and racism out there. But, you know, if we can't be seen as people and we can't be given that respect, we can't start to work on these larger issues that we're facing. And I think another misconception is that it's harmless. And I mean, everyone here has talked about time and time again about the real harm it's bringing to people's mental health. And for me, one example where I saw that is working in a city government, where I was asked by people why my nose didn't look a certain way, why my nose wasn't bigger or wider, like the Indians they've seen on TV or in different representation. And it's so hard for me to go into work and know that people aren't thinking what kind of engineering solutions I can bring to the table, but why I do or do not look like the mascots and the representation they have seen. And I've even met people who've been college educated, who are working with tribes and are doing work that affects tribes and nations, that don't know that we're still alive. And the fact that anyone could get to that point and know mascots, but not know that the Native people are still around and we're still here and present, is absurd to me. So it's not harmless. There's real repercussions. And again, even if like say I wasn't as involved in my own tribe, having people question me on how I look and how Indian I am based on these super stereotypical images is so hurtful, especially because we're such diverse group of looking people. And, you know, there's natives who look all different kinds of ways. And I think it's especially harmful for, say, like our Afro-Indigenous like brothers and sisters out there who don't even see like this poor representation of themselves displayed whatsoever. So, you know, we really need the authority to take the images into our own hand and where we're shown, how we're shown, and have that power dynamic switch. Because right now it's just one more oppressive force that's keeping us to be seen as an image, as, you know, a stereotype of what people think natives were or should be versus who we are today and who we can be.
Well, what about the simple question of why does accurate representation matter? Why does it matter, Lina?
I think it goes back to humanizing us and our experiences and our issues, and remembering that, you know, we, our lives and our experiences, they matter, and we deserve to be included in every conversation, and we deserve to not only have a seat at the table, but to have to be a leader at the table as well. Mm. So I think it's just really important to not only just be there, but to be able to be leaders in a lot of those spaces.
I mean, I think at the end of the day, representation is power. And representation, you know, in an age when we're surrounded by screens that are constantly giving us information and representing stories and media to us, you know, what is represented and how it's represented and how people think about those things are all determined by representation. You know, I'm a big NBA fan, and there's no escaping watching the NBA right now. You know, the fact that like Black Lives Matter is an incredibly important movement in our country right now, and that we need to be addressing, you know, systemic racism in criminal justice and policing. You know, like some of my favorite players are wearing, you know, say their names and equality and Black Lives Matter and all that sort of stuff on their jerseys. And that's power at the end of the day, that's power. And on the other end, you know, I think it's incredibly meaningful to people. If I think about myself as a child, it's incredibly meaningful to be seen as well, you know, to be seen and to be seen in a way that is positive, in a way that you feel accurately represents who you are and what your story is. And, you know, one sort of recent example of a piece of media and representation that I felt like made me feel like I was seen in a way that I had not been before was the book There There, written by my friend Tommy Orange, which is about the urban Native community in Oakland that I grew up in. And, you know, like the fact that there was finally, after, you know, years and years of very minimal representation of Native people in a broader sense, and very minimal representation even within sort of Native literature of urban Native experiences, you know, I've lived in the city my entire life. That was really empowering to me. And like reading that book and seeing various people and representations of you know, folks who I grew up with or places that I visited when I was a kid, and, you know, seeing Native people and Native bodies and Native stories moving through those places in a way that nobody else had depicted before, that was a really wonderful experience for me. And I imagine it was a wonderful experience for many other sort of Native people who read that book as well. And so, you know, I think on the one hand, like representation is power. It shapes what we think is important, how we think about it. And on the other hand, like representation, you know, is visibility, and is like a sense of meaning and belonging in society. And too often, you know, Native people are deprived of both of those things.
Yeah, I'm glad you brought that up with them. There, it is, and growing up in California, you're saying like seeing this story or this narrative occupying a space that you also grew up in. And also growing up in California, Brooke, you have kind of been talking a lot about like the Stanford mascots and representation, how that has been embedded in your life. Same question, why does accurate representation matter to you?
Yeah, I have 2 points on this again. The first one that Julian reminded me of is the fact with like books, all the books that we grew up reading, how so many of them, you know, has a white boy protagonist, and how we can imagine, you know, these white kids as being able to ride on dragons, being astronauts, being all these amazing things, and how that's not true for natives. When we're reading these books, we don't see ourselves, and we aren't given those possibilities to even start to think about. So it's already kind of limiting what we can do and what we're capable of in our own minds. But again, with the talk on narrative and where we are in the narrative, I wanted to bring up kind of different kind of narrative that I think is overrepresented in California per se, which is of St. Sierra. And he is a Catholic missionary who was around in the late 18th century, who is known for converting many Californians under Spanish rule to Catholicism. And the why that is problematic is because for a lot of natives, he is seen as a tyrant in California and someone who led to the death of many Native Americans in California. And I grew up on and off the reservation in California and have heard this name throughout my life. And then also it followed me all the way to Washington, D.C., because I was working for the as an intern in the Senate Committee on Indian Affairs. And when I had to run around and deliver papers, I had to walk by the statue hall where St. Sierra is, the California state statue, and know that I'm in the Senate at that moment trying to do my best to support Indian country and have this man who has killed, who has been the reason so many natives were killed in California, looking down on me in the statue hall. And not only that, he is memorialized as many monuments in California, not only the one in DC, and one was actually taken down in LA this year, but he's in monuments, he's schools' names, he's the mascot, or he's a part of several schools in San Francisco and Los Angeles. And I won't go too much into it just because there's so much information. I really encourage people to look up more about him, especially if you're from California. Julian wrote an amazing article called Native Americans Decry Sainthood for California's Iconic Missionary, if you want to find out more information. But it's really to idolize this man who for many natives was a killer, and to have him seen around all the time is a hurtful and painful reminder of our history. But not everyone's taught that history, and a lot of people go through those spaces that he is seen in without knowing the harm he has done. And even at Stanford, they had buildings named after him that they've only recently removed, I think starting in 2018. So being a California native, I had to be constantly reminded about this harmful history that other people can walk through the space without ever thinking about.
Yeah, that's amazing. I guess I didn't realize like school names, colleges, it's haunting. And it's really of this man that, I mean, a colonizer, and how they're idolized in American history. So I'm glad you brought that up, because the way that we as a nation idolize or memorialize these people are through these statues and monuments, school names, and even national holidays. So now I do want to turn our focus to the impact of memorializing through those different forms, and really focus on this national holiday of Columbus Day. Bert, growing up in New York as a Taíno person, what do you recall learning about Christopher Columbus in school?
Yeah, so first I'd just like to say thanks for having me here. It's really an honor to represent the Taíno people on such a wide-reaching platform. And one of the things that I think really sticks out to me the most about that question is not necessarily what I remember about the things Christopher Columbus did, but more how they spoke about the things that he did. And I think that so most of it is, you know, I learned that Columbus came to America and that, which is false, and that, you know, he interacted with native people there, which were the Taíno, but that really wasn't the full story, right? And when I learned eventually the real story from my father, I was really sort of horrified to find out that the year 1492 irreversibly changed Taíno shores. There were really vibrant and culturally rich communities that were destroyed as a result of, you know, Christopher Columbus's supposed exploration. And so that's one of the things that I really wish, you know, people were taught more about surrounding Christopher Columbus.
That's you said it right in there. When you learn the truth about it, so clearly what we're learning in schools isn't really the reality. Dylan, what do you recall learning about Christopher Columbus in your schools?
Well, first of all, thank you for having me. I'm very honored to be here today. I'm Dylan Baca. I'm a member of the White Mountain Apache tribe, and through my Che, I am Navajo. I currently serve as president of the Indigenous Peoples Initiative. So in school, learning about Christopher Columbus was Christopher Columbus sailed the ocean blue in 1492. This really heroic tale of a person so-called discovering a new world. And even when I went into high school accelerated programs, the real narrative was not taught. It was the Native Americans were there, they were discovered, and Christopher Columbus discovered what is now known as America. That narrative was false and has led to inaccurate representations that has been perpetuated for centuries through that discovery and colonization.
And then looking at that story and that narrative, Columbus Day and Columbus statues hold a lot of meaning to Italian Americans, as that was a way for them to celebrate and really feel acceptance into American society, because, you know, they were greatly discriminated against. And seeing him depicted was a way of honoring and celebrating their own culture. But for Indigenous people, the impact of Columbus and his arrival in the Caribbean resulted in devastation that both of you pointed out. So we see Columbus depicted as a villain and a hero. Can someone be both? Julian.
So I went to Columbia University, which is named for the poetic form of Columbus. If you hopped on the one train, you'd go downtown to 59th Street, where if you got off the subway, you'd be encountered with a giant statue with Columbus at the top. And, you know, it was a very real thing in New York City. Of course, there's a major Italian American population that says that, you know, Columbus is part of their heritage and they claim him that way. But I guess the question for me is, like, you know, is that really what's being celebrated with Columbus, with stories like and you know, children's rhymes like, you know, Columbus sailed the ocean blue in 1492. Is that what's being, you know, celebrated when we talk about his discovery and conquest of you know, the Caribbean and then the subsequent conquest of the United States and North and South America? And, you know, I think that there's also a relevant question here about whether there might not be other figures in Italian heritage or Italian American history who might be equally, if not more worthy of celebration. You know, I think that it's often said, for example, that Confederate heroes and monuments are part of the South's heritage and history. But of course, you know, many people recognize that that is to the detriment of Black people in the United States. And I think that we need to be recognizing a similar toll that, that Columbus represents for Indigenous people.
Yeah, so really showing both narratives. Dylan, what do you think? Can someone be both the villain and the hero? And how do we share that?
I think somebody can. And I think we've definitely seen that that kind of viewed within Columbus, viewed as both a hero in the Italian-American culture, as well as villain in Native American culture. And there's that great divide between both. Italian-Americans don't have many historical figures or popular figures that can be well promoted, especially to the effect of having somebody discovered something. And since there are so few Native Americans due to colonization, we do have figures that stand out amongst others and gives us more of a platform than said Italian Americans. And I think, you know, viewing somebody in both ways helps us to understand other perspectives, the Italian American perspective, as well as our own perspective, and help us to formulate not only our own narrative, but work to create a more accurate one as well.
Absolutely. Bert, do you want to add on to that? Kind of carrying both narratives about Columbus?
Yeah. So I think personally, when we try to evaluate whether someone is a villain or a hero, what we need to do is first take the sum total of their actions, right? And we need to account for all of the things that they have done and the consequences of those things before we can really, you know, evaluate whether they are a hero or a villain. And I think if we do that, Columbus certainly left a lot of destruction in his wake. And I don't know if we can call him a hero for, you know, that destruction, I guess.
Yeah, that's a great point. It is really hard to see him as a hero, again, as Indigenous people. So, you know, maybe that is why we see this current movement across the nation to change the holiday and remove these monuments around the contested historical figures like Christopher Columbus and now the Confederate statues. When we are doing this, are we erasing our history when we take down a holiday or change a holiday and take down a statue? Dylan.
I don't think we're erasing history, as some may call it. I think we are trying to promote an accurate one. One that represents an often marginalized population. For example, when we look at Confederate statues, there's a lot of symbolism behind them for Black Americans who see what those people did and what oppression that caused to their people. The same is viewed in Columbus. The Confederate army was not viewed as, is viewed as an enemy of the United States. And for them to be glorified, it makes no sense. But no, it's not erasing history. It's trying to present a more accurate and more representative history for Indigenous peoples.
Yeah, I really like that. It's we're not erasing, we're adding to it. And we're adding more representation, which we talked about. Julian, you talking about, you know, going to Columbia, you had a hand in creating context around even Columbus or this area. So what does that look like? Or are we erasing our history when we change a holiday or take down a statue?
No, actually, I would argue that the statues themselves are often erasing history and preventing our ability to fully understand the land and the context of the places that we walk upon. When I was an undergrad, we led a successful push through the Native student group to get a plaque on Columbia University's campus, acknowledging that it's on Lenape territory. Columbia is one of the oldest schools in the history of the United States, in the history of North America, and it took it almost 300 years, more than 300 years, to acknowledge the land that it resides upon. So, you know, I think that, you know, Columbia, the name that it had taken on after the Revolutionary War, was much more of a erasure of history than an acknowledgement of it. And I think that when we take some of these monuments down, we open up the space to, you know, fully grapple with and recognize the history that we have never done.
And thinking about, you know, erasing our history when we take these holidays or statues down, what do we gain from these actions, or what do we lose? All right, go ahead.
To be honest, I don't think we lose all that much. We definitely gain a lot from acknowledging that as I sort of mentioned earlier, the consequences of these figures who we are exalting were devastating. So I think that we gain a lot from, you know, seeing the full picture. And I think part of the push to take down those statues is part of the push to really see the full picture, and have people understand that, you know, there are more sides to the story than maybe we thought there were when this statue was first erected.
And Dylan, you've been working in your home state of Arizona to pass state and national legislation to remove Columbus Day to Indigenous Peoples Day. Why is this an important change to make?
Well, I think we've kind of, we started talking about that. It represents a more accurate and positive narrative concerning Indigenous peoples. We're working to do that on behalf of Indigenous peoples, to paint a picture that is more incorporative of the official Native American experience, and not this one that has been written for us. I think it's important, coming from not only Native Americans, but Native American youth who will be the next generation in this fight, to help construct that narrative and work with everybody to do so.
Yeah, and you started this work 2 years ago, and probably before then, but, you know, you're a senior in high school now working on this national level. What does it take to make change at a national level?
A lot of time. yesterday, we had a ginormous press conference with tribal leaders, state leaders, and some national leaders to discuss a proclamation Arizona Governor Ducey signed proclaiming October 12th, which is Columbus Day, as Indigenous Peoples Day. It was a monumental step for a conservative state, and that proclamation alone took 9 months to do. And the legislative process alone, you know, can be dragged out into June, and all the behind scenes work starts now, specifically with making sure you have your allies, making sure you know how everybody's going to vote, and making sure that we have the ability to push out this statewide and national campaign to make those happen. So it takes a concerted effort of many to inspire change.
And a time, 9 months to get this national change and efforts. And it has been quite a while that Indigenous peoples have been fighting to change Columbus Day. And if that change comes and we replace Columbus Day with Indigenous Peoples Day on a national level, what does that national holiday look like? And how should we celebrate Indigenous people? Bert?
I think that's a really great question. And the answer kind of lies in the entire conversation that we've been having so far. And I think one of the biggest things is just accurate representation, right? So a holiday where an accurate representation of Native peoples is celebrated, and, you know, and whether that be you know, lifting natives who are involved in film and media and, you know, sort of spreading awareness about their efforts, or, you know, native people who are in STEM and, you know, spreading awareness of their efforts. I think it can take a lot of different forms, but at the core of it, it's really just an accurate representation of who we are. And as Brooke, Lina, and Julian touched on earlier, really how different and unique we all are also.
Yeah, I'm glad you brought that up on STEM, both you and Brooke doing that work. And so, yeah, as celebrating Indigenous People Day, it's acknowledging the amazing work that Indigenous people do. Julian, what would that celebration look like to you?
So growing up in Oakland, in the Bay Area, you know, one of the most important sort of parts of the Native rights movement actually emerged out of the urban Native community that I grew up in. And that was the occupation of Alcatraz. And so every Indigenous People's Day, when I was a little kid, we would go to Alcatraz to participate in a sunrise ceremony to honor and carry forward the legacy of that occupation. And you know, some of the goals of that occupation have still not been fulfilled. There was a goal to start a cultural center for Native people on the island. That has not yet happened. It's been over 50 years now. And so I think that, you know, looking back at some of these, you know, historic moments for Native people and carrying forward the legacy of Native rights, Native treaty rights, Native sovereignty and self-determination, that's what it would look like for me. And I think that a lot of those models and examples already exist in our history and already, you know, happen every single year on Indigenous Peoples Day.
Dylan, what do you have in mind as a way to celebrate Indigenous people on Indigenous Peoples Day?
So I think part of it is us working together in creating something that is culturally representative of Native Americans. So, and working to create that accurate, that accurate and positive narrative concerning our people. That's important that we all have representation that we feel comfortable with, especially when Indigenous peoples are such a diverse community within our nation. That's important.
Absolutely. And even just a little bit of working together, you know, bringing people like you, all of you on this panel to come together and talk about it. And that's the way of having the conversation, is to celebrate Indigenous Peoples Day. But beyond this national holiday, where the efforts are changing, how does the Indigenous narrative become better entwined with our national narrative? Bert, what do you think?
Yeah, I think that's a tough question. But I think one of the easiest things that we can do is just starting somewhere, right? And if that is changing Columbus Day to Indigenous Peoples Day, then as a nation, we are already acknowledging that there was a group of people here that, you know, we wronged, and we need to sort of correct that. And that's really the first step to bringing people together, is really just acknowledging that they're there.
Yeah, I mean, I really agree with what Bert just said, but I would add that I guess one of the more inspiring things that happened recently for me was watching the 1619 project led by Nicole Hannah-Jones at the New York Times, you know, really take off and now make it into classrooms where young people are going to learn about the original sin of slavery and the way that that deeply shaped United States history from its inception, you know, from 400 years ago in 1619, when the first slaves from Africa arrived on these shores. You know, I think it's high time for a similar reckoning with the original sin of settler colonial genocide that happened on this land. And what that would look like, you know, in my view, is a greater understanding, for example, of not just the Constitution as a founding document, but also treaties, for example, as founding documents. The understanding that the Constitution describes treaties as, quote, the supreme law of the land, but that in almost every single instance, Congress has broken those treaties, and that that is news to most Americans. Most people don't know about the treaties, don't know that they're broken, don't know that they probably live on land that is governed by a treaty. And so I think that, you know, returning to that history and understanding sort of the nation-to-nation treaty-based relationship of the United States government to tribes would make a whole lot of difference for our people.
Dylan, how does the Indigenous narrative continue and become better entwined?
So to begin, the Native American story is not somehow the underbelly of our greater collective story. It is central to our American story. I think a lot of that has to do with education. You know, my mother is a curriculum developer on the reservation, and she works to include programming that is culturally relevant to Native Americans. I think if we were to introduce programming like that, not only to Native American schools, BIE-run schools, but if we were to focus on, you know, pubs and include that in curriculum, we can work to remove the stigmatism surrounded by that and work to have these conversations of inclusivity and work to build each other and unify each other.
That's amazing. So we're starting on our, what we've been talking about is like a national level. Dylan, you are doing legislative work and also getting into education and having these conversations. I want each of you to answer, what is one specific action youth can make in their own communities? Brooke, let's start with you.
For one action, I would say something that you could do today is just start a dialogue. Start a dialogue with your family, your friends, ask questions on why we have these mascots and monuments and what can be done and how it makes people feel about it. So just starting to have those conversations and making it a normal conversation to have.
Yeah. Lina, what's one action youth can make in their own communities?
Same, I guess I was gonna say the same thing as Brooke. You know, when you're having those conversations with your friends and your family, it's really, good to like start that soon. But also if you see something that bothers you, if you see an image that makes you uncomfortable, speak up about it, because wherever that image is coming from, the person who created it or the person who's sharing it might not know that it's harmful. So speak up when you see something that makes you uncomfortable.
That's amazing. That's important. Use your voice. Julian, what's one action adding on to what Brooke and Lina are saying?
Yeah, I mean, I fully agree with Brooke and Lina that conversations and speaking up are essential parts of making change. I would just add that I think that education is an incredibly powerful tool. I believe that truth is the only ground on which justice can stand. And, you know, I think that as young people and even as you continue to grow, like, educating yourself, learning more and more about these issues can itself be an incredibly empowering thing. It's been an incredibly empowering thing for me, for sure.
Thank you. Let's keep it rolling. Dylan, what's one action that youth can make in their own communities?
A great nation does not shy away from the truth. It should strengthen us, embolden us, and fortify us. I think by recognizing an accurate narrative, we can begin to work to build a better history together, and work to recognize something that will be beneficial for all of us in the long run.
Thank you. Our last one, Bert, one action that youth can take in their own communities.
I think one of the biggest things that youth can do is sort of just promote a cultural space for diverse ideas where any voice is welcome. I think that that's really powerful, because the people who benefit from that cultural space are going to be able to create a similar space in the future wherever they go. So
that's incredible. I will like starting the conversation, speaking up, creating a safe space for that. What we've really been talking about today is a lot of the representation and where we see holes in the American story and narrative. So now envisioning leaving this conversation, what do you want the American story to be, Brooke?
For me, I want the American story to be one of honesty. Like was said before, just that there's multiple sides to all these stories and they need to be told. And not everything the United States has done has been great. And we should recognize that, because only in recognizing that can we start the healing process.
Thank you. And Dylan, what do you want the American story to be?
I think one of accurate cultural representation, one that we are, like I said earlier, not at the underbelly of the conversation, but at the forefront of the conversation. I think through that we can create an accurate narrative for ourselves, the people who came before us, and the people who will come after us, to create something that is positive for all of us.
Thank you. And Bert, you were already talking a little bit about creating the safe space. But how do we include that into the American story? And how do you vision that?
I think we should make the American story one of understanding. And it really is sort of incumbent on all of us to do that, where we approach each other, you know, with compassion and really try to seek common ground, because it exists.
Expanding on common ground, Lina, you're in the work of uplifting voices of not just Indigenous, but Black and people, other people of color. So what else do you want the American story to be?
I want us as a country, I want the country to be able to own their mistakes. And I want all of us to own our mistakes, because I know we have a lot of there's a lot of like lateral violence that I see through different communities also, which is something that I need I think needs to be addressed. But going back to what Bert said about creating a safe space for everyone, where everyone feels like heard and loved, and I think we have a long way to go, but it starts with owning our actions and owning our mistakes.
Absolutely. Really standing up for all of that. Julian, I'm really interested in hearing what you want the American story to be.
I almost feel like I'm not really ready to answer what I want the American story to be, because that feels so enormous. What I want it to do, though, is to either make space or get out of the way for, you know, Native people to actually flourish and, you know, live a dignified life. For far too long, the American story has existed at our expense. It's existed at many people's expense. It has not included us. In fact, it's often been a story of our death or marginalization or dislocation or brutalization, like all of those things. And, you know, at the end of the day, like, either it needs to make space for Native people, or it needs to get out of the way of Native people, you know, finding our truth and living in power.
Thank you for that. And thank you to all of our panelists for joining us today. This has been an amazing conversation, a lot of great takeaways, and thank you for being here. I want to thank everyone else who is supporting us in this program, and also those who came before us to make this possible. Now I would like to welcome Lakota hip-hop artist Frank Waln for a special performance joining us from his studio.
Mitaku yapi, oyate tacha o mani e macha pelo, naha iuha chante washte nape chusa pelo. Hello, relatives. I just introduced myself in my language, Lakota. I said my Lakota name is Walks with the Young Nation or Walks with the New Nation. And that name was given to me by elders in my home community. I come from the Rosebud Reservation in South Dakota. I also go by Frank Waln. I'm a Sicangu Lakota hip-hop artist, music producer, and performer. And I'm so excited to be here to share some songs with you all. This first song I'm going to do is a song I wrote about the seventh generation prophecy. A prophecy that we are all a part of. We are living, breathing prophecy. You know, ancestors said that our generation will be the ones that will come together and help heal our communities and bring back our songs and our dances, our languages, everything that was taken from us. But the prophecy also said that our generation, the seventh generation, will be the generation who will suffer the most from the colonization and genocide that our ancestors endured. So there's a lot of hope, but there's a lot of healing and a lot of pain too. So I wrote a song about what it feels like to be a part of the seventh generation. And everyone watching and listening, young and old, we are all part of that prophecy. So I want us to all remember, we are living, breathing prophecy, and we are the answer to our ancestors' prayers. This is seven, Shakoni. Seven nations of warriors will come rushing in. Our ancestors wage war with the government in the spirit of Spotted Tail and John Trudell. This is spiritual awakening. They feed us lies, but we won't take it in. Let us ride on the lands where our ancestors died, breathing life into our cultures. They said we're petrified. They tell a history that our peoples don't recognize. The U.S. government should be charged with genocide. Spitting rhymes in a time of blood quantum and suicide. We survive, staying strong. All those times we should have died. I confess, I'm depressed. Sometimes I can't take the stress. Living is a test. Distressed up in the Wild West. My fam suffers, the land suffers. I hate the silence. I hate statistics. I hate the prisons. I hate the violence. Pray for these politicians making the wrong decisions. Pray for these men that inflict this violence upon our women. They hate to see us rise. We're on their TVs, man. Remind these settlers that they're up on treaty lands. I did this with my music, a CD in my hand, a microphone in the other. Now watch me take it. This is the sound of a nation rising, a generation with a vision. We're tired of our people dying. Seventh generation, you have risen. This is the sound of a nation rising, a generation with a vision. We hear our Mother Earth crying. Seventh generation, you have risen. I ghost dance over drums. My music speaks to the young. I give my heart for the people. The revolution's begun. We're standing stronger than ever. When history weighs a ton, I'm giving thanks to Creator. We're suffering with the sun. My mother says I'm a son. My people say I'm the one. My microphone, it inspire. I fire it like a gun. Higher into their privilege, conspiring with the spirits. My environment require my lyrics be the exhibit of genius that has a plan. My allegiance is with the land. My people agreed to care for. Therefore, I'ma make a stand. My freedom is non-existent, convenient to Uncle Sam. They're colonizing our minds, we're compromising their plans. Our knowledge lives in the land, the answers live in our youth. The cancers live in our elders, I'm trying to see the truth. My brothers and sisters suffer while people silence our voices. They hold our mouths shut, then tell us that we are voiceless. But they just don't listen. Privilege is their tradition, not people in their prisons. Our sisters end up missing. I petition my position to live in conditions that kill my people, my fear, my vision. Bow down to a nation rising, a generation with a vision. We're tired of our people dying. Seventh generation, you have risen. This is the sound of a nation rising, a generation with a vision. We hear our Mother Earth crying. Seventh generation, we have risen. System tries to hold us down, it holds us down. They force our cultures underground, underground. But they ain't stopping no one now, no one now. We're stronger and we know it now, we know it now. Yeah, the system tries to hold us down, it holds us down. They force our cultures underground, underground. But they ain't stopping no one now, no one now. We're stronger and we know it now, you know it now.
So I dedicate that song to all of us, young and old, who are part of the seventh generation prophecy and who are living, breathing examples of our ancestors' prayers being answered. Thank you. This next song I'm gonna do is the first song I ever wrote on the bass. It's called My People Come From The Land. And I wrote this song and included a Lakota phrase that translates to My People Come From The Land. Because all indigenous cultures all across the world have a connection to the land. Our languages, our songs, our dances, everything, our foods, who we are, comes from the land. And land back is a popular phrase right now. And I think that's what that means, because we come from the land. We know how to keep the land the best. Give the land back to the original tenders. This is My People Come From The Land. 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 On which you stand, still fighting the man, still fighting the man. The path of the narrow's narrow. My people living in peril with several flows. I'm armed, wrestling with these devils, disheveled but never settle. These settlers ain't on my level. Give me bass, give me treble. I'm troubled but never tremble. Rekindled the seven council fires, keepers of the flame, land of the burnt thigh. It's even in my name. I'm a symbol, see chunko is how I rumble. I may stumble, but me yo yate yakichita, I never crumble. Survivors of genocide, the traumas got me trapped. I used to keep it inside until I decide to rap. My ancestors ain't die for me to lie in my raps. Can't take it sitting down, instead I'm fighting back. Buck your system, buck your capitalism. They took the land, made us sick and gave us alcoholism. They took away our wisdom, they took away our health. We're gonna get it back and we're gonna honor ourselves. My people come from the land. My people come from the land. My people come from the land. On which you stand, still fighting the man. Mitra oya te ki ma koche etan hampi. Mitra oya te ki ma koche etan hampi. To all our land defenders, all the people on the front lines, land protectors. My tribe cannot survive as long as Washichu will thrive. For centuries on this land, they committed genocide. They don't fill the land, they kill the land. Try to kill the Indian and save the man. Send the slaughter, they poison water from Flint, Michigan to Standing Rock. The land is hot, the land is hurt. I feel it too, I'm from the earth. My flesh and blood, the color of the dirt. I'm blessed enough to love my mother first. Talking Mother Earth. Unchimaha, Lakota, my culture, I wash our ya. Give me strength, hair like the land and it grow with length. Wokiksu, yeah, they cut our grandparents' braids. Took them to that boarding school where our grandparents stayed. Cut them off from the ways that their grandparents prayed. They're trying to build these pipelines over our grandparents' graves. There ain't no stopping this red light from blinding us. Ain't no stopping these problems from finding us. It's like I run with nowhere to go. My nation is a rosebud with nowhere to grow. My people come from the land. My people come from the land on which you stand, still fighting the man. Mitra oya te ki ma koche etan hampi. Mitra oya te ki ma koche etan hampi. This next song I'm gonna do, I'm tired of rapping in English. I wanna rap in my language. I'm trying to use my songwriting to learn my language. My great-grandmother took it to the grave with her. So it's a life goal of mine to learn Lakota before I die. And I'm using my songwriting, my path, my purpose, my gift, my passion to learn it and also bring it to life, hopefully through my creativity. So the song I'm about to do is called Wana We Chichaga. And this is an old Lakota phrase I learned from a Dakota uncle, actually. So what it means is Wana means now. We Chichaga means we thrive or we prosper. And when he taught me this, I was with a nephew of his, and he was telling us, teaching us this phrase. And he said, people used to say this to each other every day. Now we thrive, now we prosper, because we used to succeed and thrive and prosper together. We needed each other to thrive and prosper. We lost track of that, but I think we're getting back to that, you know, and this event is an example of that. So I took that phrase, Wana we chichaga, and he said, spread it around to the world. You guys are artists. Me and his nephew was also a hip-hop artist. Shout out Brazil DX. He said, do what you want with it. So I took that phrase, and I brought it to life through the song. It's called Wana we chichaga. Oyate, wana we chichaga, wana we chichaga, wana we chichaga, oyate, wana we chichaga, wana we chichaga, wana. Nina hiwo glake e hanta tayo, anaho tayo, anaho tayo, preta ki, ki ni ya ye, oichi yapo, oichi yapo. Nina hiwo glake e hanta tayo, anaho tayo, anaho tayo, preta ki. Kini ya ye, oishi yapo, oishi yapo, oyate. Wana we chichaga, wana we chichaga, wana we chichaga, oyate. Wana we chichaga, wana we chichaga, wana. Oyate. Wana we chichaga, wana we chichaga, wana we chichaga, oyate. Wana we chichaga, wana we chichaga, wana. Nina hiwo glake e hanta tayo, anaho tayo. Anaho tayo, preta ki, ki ni ya ye, oichi yapo, ye, nina ki mo glake e hanta tayo, anaho tayo, anaho tayo, preta ki, ki ni ya ye, oichi yapo, oyate, wana we chichaga, wana we chichaga, wana we chichaga, oyate, wana we chichaga, wana we chichaga, wana. Oyate, wana we chichaga, wana we chichaga, wana we chichaga, oyate, wana we chichaga, wana we chichaga, wana. Oyate, wana we chichaga. So the translation and the lyrics, I said oyate, which means people or nation. Now we thrive, now we prosper, wana we chichaga. Then in the verses I said, ninaki woglake e hantataya, anakoptayo, which means, when your spirit speaks, listen carefully. Then I said, Preta ki, ki niya ye, oichiapo, which means the fire was relit, talking about that spiritual cultural fire. And then said, help each other. So that fire was relit, help each other. Now we thrive, now we prosper. Thank you. This next song I'm going to do for you all is a song I wrote as a birthday present for my mom in 2011. I was in college at the time. I was a struggling student, starving artist. I was on scholarship. And her birthday was coming up. I wanted to do something really special for her that year because she's a single mother. She raised me by herself. Her and my dad split up when I was 3. But, you know, I couldn't buy her nothing because I didn't have any money. She doesn't like parties, so I wasn't gonna really throw her a party. So I decided to use my gift of songwriting to create a gift for her. And I released a song in 2011 on my mother's birthday. The song is called Like a Rock, because our love is like a rock, it always remains. We weren't perfect. Times where we hurt each other, but our love is what got us through it. '89, we said hello, he said goodbye, daddy left when I was 3, and made us cry, you and I, we had to make it, you found a way, drama came, and friends left, but mama stayed through everything. All the fights and all the shame, all the change. I hate that man, don't want his name. Told my mom that I'm a one, couldn't understand all the things going on between her and my fam. But I was stubborn, I know that it made things hard. He always said, son, I know you're gonna take things far. Believe that, I need that in dark times. I think of what you did for me and my heart shines. You took my hand up this mountain, made it your climb. So when I shine, mom, you shine. Yeah, a single mother with the odd stack. We found a way, one day I'll bring it all back. Lived all my life, just me and you. Every single storm that you see me through. Cause I ain't have a dad and we ain't need no man. Raised by a woman, you made me a man. I gotta leave home cause my heart will roam. I gotta let you know that you're not alone. Our love is like a rock and you will be my stone. Forever in my heart, forever you're my heart. You always gave me what I needed, somehow always found the time. Single parent, it's apparent that you stayed up on your grind. I remember you were putting me first. It was hard but you said, son, it could be worse. And you were right, it's funny looking back, you made it sunny. You kept me smiling even though we didn't have the money that other people did. Somehow you made it happen. I promised mama that I'm gonna do it when I'm rapping. Cause you took me everywhere in my cap and my backpack. 20 years later, now I'm rapping in snapbacks. I'm rocking these long braids. We came a long way. You kept me on the right road away from the wrong way. Forever I'm grateful for the life you gave. The tears that we cried, the sacrifice you made. Yeah, a single mother with the odds stacked. I found a way. One day I'll bring it all back. Lived all my life, just me and you. Every single storm that you see me through. Cause I ain't have a dad and we ain't need no man. Raised by a woman, you made me your man. I gotta leave home cause my heart will roam. I gotta let you know that you're not alone. Our love is like a rock and you will be my stone. Forever in my heart, forever you're my heart, you're my stone. So I dedicate that song to all of our mothers, our grandmothers, our aunties, our big sisters, all of the strong Indigenous women that are the backbones of our nations. And, you know, Lakotas were matriarchal. Women were the gravity from which our whole universe rotated around. And we're talking about memory and, you know, the past and the present and the future. And I honestly, truly know one of the ways we get back to our true selves and healing ourselves as nations is learning how to address patriarchy and honor our women in the right way. Because even as men, you can get strength from honoring our women in the right way. So shout out to all of our strong Indigenous women out there. Thank you. This song is a new song. I wrote this song recently. I was kind of overwhelmed by everything that's been happening in the world. Pandemic, you know, state violence, murdering people. We're still having to fight for our lands and our right to clean water and live. All the fires happening out in California. And that brought up an interesting topic I seen. I seen an article about how California tribes used to do controlled burns in California to help keep things in balance so that, like, what's happening now wouldn't happen. Things get out of control and just take off with fire. And how we need to get back to that so that these things don't happen again. Kind of goes back to land back, you know, just giving land back to the original caretakers who know how to caretake it and keep it in balance. And Lakotas used to do the same thing. We used to do controlled burns in the plains. And we're speaking about, you know, the past. Check this out. I have a Diné sister. She's studying Indigenous ecosystems and food systems for her dissertation. And she told me that she learned that my people, the Ocheti Shakoni, the people of the plains, we were actually scientists in the way that we use those controlled burns. And we use those controlled burns to purposely and scientifically engineer the Great Plains and the grasslands so that our buffalo could graze and we could have an ultimate source of life and food, because the buffalo was our source of everything on the earth, food, clothes. It was our main source of life in the center of our culture. And so we scientifically engineered the perfect place for the buffaloes to live in the plains before settlers came and almost wiped them out to extinction. So that also pushes it back against the notion that our ancestors didn't know what they were doing, or they weren't scientists, or they were primitive, stupid, you know? Actually, we're starting to see that they knew what they were doing better than we know what we're doing now. And so this is also a song about looking back to the past for answers. This song's called Burning Down. And this is about how sometimes things gotta be destroyed for new things to grow. Like taking down monuments of racist colonizers. Just changing people's perception of history and things, you know? Sometimes we gotta burn it down to start over. And I think our ancestors had the answers to a lot of things. So as things burn down, let's look back to the way our ancestors did things. And sometimes they burn things down. It is burning.